Opposing Gloves here, and today we are going to finish the chiptune series. We're going to do, this is a little bit of bonus, we're just going to do a mixdown. This is a preview. I'm going to play it through for you right now for the beginning. And what it is we have our mix, we have mixed it, and we've got a small little mastering deal going on. Nothing crazy, because it's a chiptune track. Like, we're not out there for like this crazy mastering session, all that. Just a simple limiter at the end will kind of fulfill our needs. And we do two mixes. We do a static and a dynamic mix. You'll hear about that from me again in a second. So without further ado, here's the mix we are going to accomplish. And if you're watching this van, here's the mix we accomplished. And I think we have a pretty solid track. So here we go. So this isn't going to be a completely finished mix down, but we're just going to go through, we're going to mix it. And I like to do my mixes in two stages, and just real quick, take note of what it is we're dealing with. We are dealing with a chiptune song. So chances are we don't really care very much about an incredible master, and we don't care that we get our mix right within a certain dynamic range and all this other stuff. For more complicated genres, that may be much more of a, well, that is a thing. But for stuff like chiptune, not so much a thing. So we can sort of relax in those regards. Now, this whole time I've been clipping the living snot out of what's going on up here. And that's totally fine because we are in our creative stage. Now we are going to go to the mix page, which we have not looked at, I believe, once. That tends to be how it goes with when I'm working in Renoise. So at this stage, I like to reorganize my stuff And the first thing I do is I turn everything down to negative infinity. And I do not know of a way. And I searched for quite a while on how to turn, how to select multiple channels and turn them all off at the same time. But I don't know of a way. So I do it this way. Okay, so this send track is unnecessary. I kept it around, but at this point, we can just get rid of it. And now we have nothing. And so what I like to do there, so there are the two stages. There's the static stage, and then there is the dynamic stage. So the static stage of mixing, for me, this is sort of something, I've got terms for it now, I suppose, is I pick a section of the song, and I will mix that song. Usually it's the loudest part of the song, the part with the most stuff. And I'll mix it to sound as great as I can possibly make it. After I have it as great as I can possibly make it, I will then mix dynamically, meaning I will go through the song section by section and automate everything to make it custom fit amazingness for that particular segment of the song. Because maybe the amazing mix I get for over here is a static mix, doesn't jive so well with the mix over here. And maybe even when I have my static mix, I could go through and embellish things here. This allows me to consider the song as a whole before I go in and consider the song as elements. Because some people, what they'll do is they'll start automating right away, and then they realize they want to do some more general changes, and the process isn't, you have more unnecessary steps. So what we're going to do is we're just going to get started here. So the first thing is I have my lead layer. I want all my samples, all my kick. So that's going to be orange. I'm going to hit Control G, and that's going to be a group, and I'm going to name it the drums group, and I'm going to add all my drum stuff to the drums group and things of a percussive nature. I'm actually going to leave my effect out of it because I may affect it separately, and the point of a group is so that if you want, you can affect things as a group. So the snare is a snare. I'm going to make it orange, and the drum group will be orange. And the hi-hat, of course, and the fast hat. These are all elements of my drum group. I also went through and spiffied up a lot of parts of this track to make it sound a lot better. But right now, everything's down, so I cannot show you. Okay, and then the lead. So I move my drums to the front. And the reason I do this is because if you're going to use a signal follower to do side chaining, your kick needs to be before it in a signal chain. As a result, I put my kick at the front. It's that easy. The bass pads, I like to have similar parts together. Harp, bass, and then the reverse sample can go over here next to the drums. So the lead layer, I want it to be purple as well. Otherwise, it will confuse me. Actually, I'm kind of used to it being red, so I guess I'll keep it red. In this case, I usually save red. If I have guitars in a song, the guitars are red. So, okay, that's what we have so far. Now the next stage, so I save that. And now the next stage I do is I go to the segment I think has the most stuff. And in this case, I think it's the second drop. I think the second drop has the most stuff. What is this? Oh, this is the drum track. I'm like, there's an empty track here. What is that? Oh yeah, it's the drums. Okay, so with this, I'm going to start with the drums. It's very common. But for the static mix, let's go ahead and do that. So first, I'm going to set my levels. I look at my panning. I use auto panners quite a bit. And I've noticed that meld to audio stuff is, for whatever reason, it makes Renoise flip out like crazy. So I try to avoid their stuff. But I use Neutron a lot in this particular DAW. Actually, I've noticed it in several DAWs. I don't know what it is about their plugins, but they do some weird things sometimes. So anyways, I'm going to start playing. I want to play from here. I've set up a loop, so it'll loop through, and we'll start out with the kick. Okay, and what I'm going to do is I'm going to do two things. I'm going to add a Neutron. I'm sorry if you don't have Neutron. You can use other plugs. Essentially, Neutron's like an EQ and a compressor and a bunch of other stuff. It comes with some nifty features. I'm going to name this instance the kick. And you see I get an EQ and all this stuff. So I'm going to immediately start EQing. I'm going to take out some mud. So we wrote in the key of C major, and it tells you the note you're at. So I'm going to just stick that at a C. Maybe make this a little more severe and bring up some mid-range. Some people call this the snap. So without five, with five. So you see, that's a tonal change. I tend to, in renoise, it gets like things are still a little weird. So I don't worry as much about the signals here. I worry about what's coming out at the end. Something I want to do with the kick is turn on a transient master and give it a slight bit of attack and take away just a touch of the sustain. So without it, this is a little more dull. So that'll help it cut through just a touch. I've seen some people, what they do is they'll put a little bit of white noise before their kick. That comes with some side effects, though, that I'm not the craziest about. Oh, one other thing they have on is they have this compressor on. I don't want that on. They have this track assistant feature, too. I don't find myself using that all that much, but it's there. So, yeah, they're like they're at my neighbor's house, firefighters and all this stuff. This is crazy. So let's bring up the snare. Now in chiptune, that ch is like specifically what I want. It's kind of like weird. It's like the crappier sounding snares are like more popular. But I still use a neutron because the neutrons can talk to each other and they can see each other. And that can come in handy later if I want. That's a little too much. Okay, so that's nice. Now this one, now hats like this, what I like to do is give them a free plugin. It's a free plugin. It's all covered in my free plugins playlist. It's called Pancake, and it's an auto panning plugin, and it's freaking awesome. So you can go check that out. I explain how it works and all this stuff, but what I like to do is just give it some random sort of deal and then make the speed of not crazy fast, make it 4 bars. I think they're knocking on our door now. I might have to go. And so here it goes. And then what I'll do is I'll bring the mix down so that these extremities are a lot more narrow. So it's just slightly moving around there in the middle. This just frees up room. Really subtle reasons why this may or may not be a good idea. I think it's mostly a good idea in something like this. So there you go. If you were doing like a live drum kit, some people like to make the hat be like where it actually is positioned in the drum kit. And that's fine too. It's just different ideas. In this case, I think this is a cool idea. So I'm also going to add a neutron. Seriously, the more I've used Neutron, the more I've been like, freaking Neutron is awesome. What I'm going to use it for, in this case, if we turn the compressor off, is I'm going to first I want a little boost just to define it sort of as a sound, and then I'm going to bring down some of the transient. I'm going to transient master this, bring out some of the sustain so it has a sharper. It's too far apart. Let's go with. Okay. And, you know, I'm thinking of adding verb. They have a width, which I believe is just a delay. So I'm fine with that. And on this, I'm also going to add a pancake. This one's going to be a lot less severe as a thing. So we get this. And that's good. Okay, cool. So drums are done. So I'm going to go up to the top and let's toss in the lead. And so on the lead, I'm going to now add a neutron. Now, it's totally okay. Neutron. It's totally okay. Not the compressor, though. I don't want the compressor. You generally don't need compressors all that often for electronic music. For like things like actual compression, because if you're working with MIDI, you can just write the volume the way you want. If you're working with samples, then yeah. And then there's the whole side chaining and kick thing, which you use it for tons. I'm talking about like compression as like to actually compress the dynamic range. Like it's usually considered like generally, I guess it depends on your philosophy. So, but I've found that you can almost get exactly what you want just by automating your volume just the way you want. You can do that with regular stuff too, but there it's a lot less intuitive. Whereas in when you're writing each sound from scratch anyways, it's a little more intuitive. That was it's freaking loud. Now check this out. Masking, we can see where our kick is, and it gives us a histogram. Also going to match that with this. Let's see where if it clashes with the snare anywhere. So we can just switch to the snare. That's all high harmonic stuff. Doesn't matter. So, okay, cool. So let's bring in the counter, which is the other most common thing. So something I didn't do was automate panning. That's a dynamic move. So we'll deal with that in the dynamic stage. Thank you. Saw. Where do I use this? Way up here. Oh. Okay. Okay, so I'm going to add a signal. So this is called a signal follower, and you add it, then what it allows you to do is we can target various instruments. So right now it's on current track, but let's target the ARP after the pad. So this ARP, which is on track 12, and we're gonna target the mixer on it, and we're gonna control the volume. And what we're going to do is we're going to make it so that when the kick hits, it will turn down. That's what I just did. So you can see it. Now you see this is separate from the track mixer channel. This is controlling this, which is part of the reason why I was so confused when I first started doing this, because I was like, what the heck is going on here? Now for the pad, I've already sculpted out a lot of the low end, so I probably don't need to worry about it too much. But let's go ahead and throw a neutron on there and just go for that as well. If you watch Isotope mixing videos, I was watching one, they're like, just throw a neutron on every channel as your first move. And it's kind of funny. I don't know if I'd go that far, but it is pretty useful to have. So I'm just going to shave off stuff I don't need down here. Throw in. Now we're still missing the bass. Wow, the bass really fills it up. Now this is the bass part, and this is used way up here. Oh, I remember why we use this. Okay, and then let's go in and deal with the bass, right? Okay, so now I'm going in the red too, and this is where people who like mixing, you generally wouldn't do this, but it's a chiptune track. It's the fact that we're going at this degree with it is amazing. So, first off, we want it to drive well with our kick. And it's nice because we can see exactly what's going on with our kick. So this is just tends to be what happens. And so you can either do you want my bass to be the big thing or the kick to be the big thing. I'll probably remove some from it and try to find a happy middle ground. And then I'll remove some high frequencies and hopefully make room for the snap of the kick. And that will make the kick sound a lot more powerful and also pop through on phones. So we'll see what we can find. Every time it's a different battle. So making room for the kick and the snare and sculpting out. And as you can see, all I'm doing is I'm just going to accentuate the parts that aren't interfering. It will sound great. Well, it sounds great. But you should, again, this is one of those things, use your ears before your eyes. But I'm telling you, it's pretty nice seeing exactly what frequency it is, so you don't have to go hunting. Because you have to do that whole sweep thing. That's cool, but it could just take forever sometimes. And also, depending on the plugs, here it's not a huge deal. I just want to make it more clear. I think we've got it. So I'm going to target the kick a little bit. The bass a little bit with this. Just a hair. Mixer. Volume. So I'm for the static mix portion, I'd spend some more time. But for the sake of what we're doing, I think it sounds pretty good. Let's go ahead and move into the dynamic portion. Okay, so we start with the beginning. And in this portion, I oftentimes spend more time in the edit mode. For whatever reason, I end up here because I usually end up automating plugins. So this is where I go. So we start off with this, right? So let's go ahead and focus on this. So on the counter, we have these long notes, and we can make this a little more musical simply by changing the volume up. So the volume, though, needs to have a set beginning. So I'm going to set that at 0. And so now it has been set. So here I could have a swell. And this won't affect later on down in the track. Do I have something going on here else? I think that's fine. There's not a ton to do here. What we could do on the lead is mess with the width at the beginning. Cool. I think that's cool. Oh, you know what else would be cool? Let's go to the counter. Also change the width. It gets so soft right here. What is up with how soft it gets? What did I do in the mixer? Yeah, I don't know why it's that soft right there. Let's fix it. Okay. Now I'm on this these pad things. I'm gonna automate the panning on these. That's cool. Something else, let's do this now. I don't worry about mastering really on these sorts of tracks because they're not like, they're not in need of mastering really. So what I'll do on my master is I treat my mix more like my master. And I like to toss on just like a vintage limiter from like Ozone or something, and just turn the threshold true peak. I'll bring it down like 1 dB or something. And I usually stick with the analog. I'll mess with character usually just, and I'm just paying attention to drums mostly when I do that. I don't worry too much. It would affect my ARP and other stuff like that, but not in a way that's like as important as the drum relationship. So I'm just adding some variety here. And on this, the panning could be kind of cool. Let's go up all the way up to the panning. Deserve a volume increase there. So this is just like stuff that musicians would do. If this was instruments musicians were playing, this is what the stuff they would do. They would, well, they wouldn't necessarily be panning, but they'd, you know, do volume changes. Go back up here. Okay, so we have these long tones. I'm gonna add in a down. Sound kind of cool. Maybe a slight up here. Thank you. change the width some. We should go and take a look at our limiter. Just make sure it's doing stuff we want it to. Oh my gosh, mix page. This isn't the mixer though. Oh, this is the mixer. What the heck is going on right now? I don't even know. It's because this automation thing is throwing me off. So let's go ahead. Let's try tube. It's not doing all that much. Now the bass is way much less bass. Okay, so let's consider this middle section here real quick. Okay. So I'm gonna just boost this kick up just a touch more. And look for those, I don't know. It's got kind of the balance I want it to have. So something that is definitely too loud is that hi-hat. So let's go fix that. That's just too loud. Okay, fast hat. You do not need to be that loud. Because we looped. That's why that happened. Okay. Okay, so here is sort of a delicate spot, but I need that hat line, the one that I just turned down a crap ton, to come back at a very loud and obnoxious rate. So we're going to go to volume. Oh, and I see I have some unusual volume moves. So I see I did some interesting. I did use the re-trigger command and did some fun stuff there. Why did this not trigger? Did it trigger? Did I not turn the reverse sample effects up? Did I miss that? I totally missed that. I just noticed that. Well, let's fix that. Yeah, I might be able to boost this louder than it was originally. I think that's about right. Let's go check it at the top here. Okay, just a touch softer up here. Oh, my bad. I'm in the wrong pattern. I dig it. Okay, cool. That explains what was throwing me off a little bit. Okay, let's make sure I'm not missing anything else. All my faders are active, so I'm good. So we are now here. Sorry, I had to just make that adjustment real quick. Okay, let's go back over here. Whoa, that's crazy. This is a spot to bring out those moments in the hi-hat where they do that thing and keep them the same and bring it out right there, back down. Oh, I was late. This is the moment I was looking for. Not that one. So something cool we could do here, and I'm prone to type this in instead, that's pan, but I've never used the call and pan command before, so I'm just going to use automation. That's another command I should familiarize myself with a bit better. So it starts right here, so we start center, and then it'd be cool to go down. Whoops, wrong spot. This thing is very sensitive to where your mouse is, like incredibly inconvenient level sensitivity sometimes. It's a little extreme. Dial it back. And we get something like that, which I think will work out. Thank you. I felt like my role of melody was challenged up here. So I may want to make efforts to bring it out, but at the same time, I was kind of okay with it. The thing that was challenging it the most was the chords. So let's figure out what's going on over there. These pads, the pads. On the note of the pads, they are just sucking up so much room. They are literally just, everyone's taking, it's just taking everybody's stuff. So let's go ahead and clean up the pads. And what I'm thinking of doing, now I'm hesitant on the pads, because the pads, and that lands on the beat, which I don't really want the kick to be diminishing that stuff. Right there, see, melody sings through there, so it might just be okay at this point. Something we can have more fun with at the drop repeat is the movement of these panning lines. So I think that's actually the mix I want. I didn't have to do as much as I thought I would need to do to that chord line. So let's, I want it to start out, go down some. That line right there, da na 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 na. Where are you? There, I'm gonna reduce the volume to 60. 60, maybe even 50. 80 is max in the volume column. I don't know the reason, but it's 80 is the max. That just takes out some of that, like, that. This is really shrill, just that one note, so just turn down that one note, right? It's basically compression. Here, too, I'm going to take it down to 60. Now, if you think this is crazy, man, I had some mixed projects where I was only allowed to use volume and panning, and you could not use anything else. So if you wanted to do compressor, you went in there and did every volume move yourself, and you began to realize that a lot of times that's kind of better than letting a compressor half do the job you wish it had done. So other times, it makes you think about compressors differently because you think about them for their sound and quality rather than a cheap way out of doing small moves, because later on you're like, man, I could have had it sounding like this instead of this thing. And so it's like, so I don't know. Changed my opinion about a lot of things. On this vibrato, let's make this a 5. See if that pops out more. They also have I'm not sure if it works like this, but they have an in volume command where it's an increase in volume by the amount you specify. So that could be like a crescendo essentially. Oh, but I need to be up a bit more. Cool. And also that's a clashing note right there. And I found that, let's just select it and just bring it up by one semitone. Down by one semitone, I mean. fixed it. And that was a problem earlier in the first drop that I fixed. And I made a mental note. I forgot about that mental note, but I've come back and fixed it now. It's not a problem later on because they both play B natural. I don't know when I made that decision. I also found a problem with one of the bass notes, and I went in and fixed that too. So, okay. I think this sounded pretty solid. Something weird. Do it again. Is that part? Did I write that part differently? Is that really how it goes? I'm gonna really quick fill that in. This is calling. Instruments. No way this is instrument 6. It's instrument 0. The octave is 6. Do-do-do. That's just kind of weird. That. I dig it. I like that. Okay, so come out of our thing and the ember. So we're approaching the end of what I would call the first run of the dynamic stage. So we did our static mix, got it sort of somewhere where we liked. I didn't pay careful heed to levels and stuff. A lot of times I'll consider that stuff a little bit more. That's when you start breaking out compressors and doing things like that. But in this particular, the thing we're trying to do doesn't really call for that level of attention. It's not really necessary. But we've got through, we've made things dynamic and active. We've deliberately added interest in some spots just for the heck of it. So that things, it just, there's like a special layer of interest, like you listen and you say this is more interesting, but you can't quite pinpoint what it is. It's just like all these small changes. It's like organic. It's like you're looking at a natural lawn. There's all these small changes, and that's what makes the lawn look natural. If you saw a lawn where every blade of grass was the same, it'd feel really uncomfortable, and you'd probably be able to tell what was putting you off in that case. But you know how you can tell an astroturf lawn against like a regular lawn, even if they were like made to be identical, it'd be like you could tell which one's more natural. It's the same deal here. We don't have a plastic shine. We have like a natural smooth shine, like the morning dew rather than the plastic feel and look. So that's sort of what I aim to achieve in a mix. So see right here, I thought about this. I'm gonna do it. So I'm gonna mess with the width here. And I think I already have width on it? I think I already do. It's at 22%, so I don't wanna mess that up. So I'm gonna put that 23 and whatever is fine. So bring the width up. And one thing that's kind of cool if you've never done it is the idea of going from in a climax. So you have like your riser and everything is stereo before, and as you rise, it slowly becomes more mono and filtered. Like you just bring stuff out till it comes down to this little dot of frequency that's mono. And then when your drop hits, you explode that sucker open. You just open it wide and it's like bang, stereo image. It's got all the frequencies. I mean, it's incredible. The first time I tried that, I was like, holy freaking crap, this is amazing. I'm thinking about doing it for the end here. It'd be kind of a cool trick. unexpectedly moved more to the left than I had anticipated it would. I don't want it that far to the left. So that's just loads clearer. So let's just do a quick playthrough. That's where I'm going to leave you. So congratulations on making it to the end of this series. I hope you have learned many things, looked at a track. This mixing thing was just sort of an extra deal, but you've seen a lot of creative techniques I've used. You've seen a lot of just things I think about when I'm making a track. I get stuck. What do I do? We didn't really get stuck too bad on this one, but structure-wise, because you could strive, maybe you want to make this like a way crazier thing. It could be a totally different thing. Chiptune, though, obviously, it's not like, you don't have to get insane with this sort of a thing. And other genres, you may get a little more crazy. But again, that's up to the composer. Maybe you're going to do a mixed genre or whatever. If this was helpful, list whatever you thought was the most useful thing in this series. And I would appreciate that. Just to know, like, hey, keep doing this thing. That's often better than... stop doing this thing, because what if I stop doing something you like? You know, I don't know. Anyways, this is the preview. I'm going to play it through for you right now for the beginning. And what it is we have our mix. We have mixed it and we've got a small little mastering deal going on. Nothing crazy because it's a chiptune track. Like, we're not out there for like this crazy, crazy mastering session, all that. Just a simple limiter at the end will kind of fulfill our needs. And we do two mixes. We do a static and a dynamic mix. You'll hear about that from me again in a second. So without further ado, here's the mix we are going to accomplish. And if you're watching this video, here's the mix we accomplished. And I think we have a pretty solid track. So here we go. Thanks for watching. Subscribe and have a blessed day.